Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an investigative independent journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in the Lake Lure area of Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Today, Tuesday, May 7, 2024, I'm going to share with you what was discussed at last night's Rutherford County Commissioners meeting. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com and follow me on social media. On X, formerly Twitter, at Annie M. Dance, and other social media channels as well. So if you go to the Rutherford County government website, rutherfordcountync.gov, click on Webcasts and Agendas, that opens up into another window called Granicus that the county uses to archive and stream their meetings. So when you click on that, you can dive into all of what lives there, including the agenda video. You can also listen to it on these various links. So you can also do a search for keywords, which is very helpful, for me when I'm researching different things. I'm going to play a highlighted portion involving the Moseley Architects presentation, which again is also linked in the meeting itself.
Is 3760. This is actually an update from Moseley Architects for Rutherford County Detention Center. And I'd like to recognize Mr. Payne and Mr. Davis. Are they here this evening? There's one of them. Right, come on up, Dylan. Thank you so much, Doma. I appreciate you allowing them to be able to join us tonight. In April of 2023, this board approved professional services with Moseley Architects, who conduct a space needs study for the county's detention center facility. And tonight, we've invited them back to be able to share some conclusions and a presentation based on their study. So thank you so much for having us. Mr. Payne.
Thank you.
Oh, pass that on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tonight, we've got Brian Payne in our office. My name is Todd Davis. I head up our justice sector. We worked on this project together with multiple of our engineers, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, security, kind of look at you, identify your space needs and conditions of your current facility and maybe options to move forward. Now, the current jail's maintenance issues are ongoing. Your county's done a really good job at the age of that and the fact that it houses residents that don't want to be there and don't want to take care of it. That kind of creates a problem in itself. You know, so we kind of put together your bed projections to look at where you're going to be through 2045 based on county population, admission rates. We'll kind of touch on those here in just a minute. And then some architectural options, whether it's an addition or looking at a new facility, kind of address those long-term needs. Probably see that. The state rated capacity of your facility is 208 beds. What that does is it says that you, when you built this, you had 208 beds that were rated by the state to house inmates. What it does not do, in order to have 208 inmates in there, would have to be almost like a perfect world, the same type of offenders that could classify. One example would be if you had 48-bed female unit and you only had 24 females, then you can't put 24 of anything else in there. So 24 empty beds would make up that 208. So when I say it has to be a perfect world, that classification of inmates per that housing, there's a term called operational capacity, which is operational capacity is like 75% of what your rated capacity. When you reach that number, you're technically full. When you have co-defendants, you have gang members, you have different classifications that can't be housed together, so you have to have the ability to separate them. Another thing is we say that jails age kind of in dog years. Because once they open, they never close. And they're open 24/7, 365, unlike any other county building. So if you have a broken laboratory in the jail, in other buildings, if it's broken, people can just move down the hall to another one that's maybe not, but in the jail, you can't do that. So they age a lot quicker. Some of the bed projections. We used, to do your county bed projections, we kind of used your county population from the State Office of Budget Management, which most counties, that's what they use for their county population growth. We used six years of data to go back historically to look at where you're at. 2017, you admitted 4,300 into the jail, and then it kind of went down. 2019 was the onset of the pandemic. In 2020, you'll see how those numbers kind of went down a little bit. 2020 was your lowest point with 3,467 that were admitted. And then you can see that number starting to go back up in 21 and 22. We finished this report in December of 23. So in 22, you were at 4,404 inmates that were admitted to your facility. Using that admission rate together with your county population, we projected through 24 and 5-year increments what your admissions would be. Your admission rate was based on how many people were admitted per 10,000 of county population. So in 2025, we're projecting 4,441, and then in 2045, 4,647.
I mean, what an adventure. It's
like, I can't hardly see that.
Right. It's the next slide.
Yeah.
I'm just going to pause this for a moment to give some more context to this. So although the county population has declined per the census data, I know from anecdotal evidence and from covering crime and politics in the county for a few years that that's not entirely an accurate number. And then when you think about people who are coming into Rutherford County for various reasons, the county population, there's an assumption there, and I'm not sure if that's what that's based on. There's an assumption that people who are going to the county jail live in the county, and that's certainly not always the case. There's not great data out there to distinguish between the two. However, I know that from anecdotal evidence and again from covering crime in the area. So if you look back at my past reporting, you can see examples of that. Another note it's unclear why this presentation took over a year to be implemented and to be publicly discussed. Again, at the April 2023 meeting, the county commissioners approved a contract to award Moseley Architects with the space needs study. I spoke at that meeting and I raised questions in the public comment section about how Moseley Architects was selected. I still have a lot of questions surrounding that, but I will play this through and you can hear for yourself what the findings are.
One thing that is important to know is the average length of stay. That's the single most important number that drives your needed bed count. I was pleased to see that your average length of stay is a lot better than counties. I mean, I've probably done 60% or better of the county jail bed projections in North Carolina, and y'all's is in pretty good shape at 17.79. The national average is between 10 and 20 days. North Carolina's usually between 12 and 25. I don't see a red flag go up until it's 25 days or more. And usually I have to explain that to people that work in the facility because they go, well, we've got people that's been here 3 years. Well, this is looking at every single person that's admitted to the jail, whether they're there for 30 minutes or they're there for 4 years, that you're still responsible for the ones being admitted. So overall, looking at every single one of your admissions, you know, almost 18 days, it's not bad. It means what that tells us is that your criminal justice system is actually processing inmates through the system at a fairly good rate. However, we do know that that needs to be constantly monitored, because going up 2 days could make a big difference in your overall bed needs. Talk about peaking ratios. Your peaking ratio, peaking is at times throughout the year that your admissions in your average daily population is much higher. When people are admitted, it could be for a multitude of reasons. DEA could be doing a drug roundup, probation, parole could be doing a roundup. Sheriff may have just served a lot of warrants, anything that makes that peaking go up. That's important to know, because you still have to place to put those. And what we do is we looked at every single day for 6 years, not just a week here, a week that quarter. We looked at every day. I got all of those, all of the intake releases from the county for 6 year period, and kind of calculated that. Your peaking ratio is a little bit higher than what I was expecting. I think it's, your peaking ratio was like 1.16 or 1.24 was the average. Typically, we see that in the 1.16, 1.17. All that means is at certain times of the year, you were getting a lot more inmates in than normal. But with your average length of stay being so good, the peaking ratio did not have that big of a factor like we see in some counties. Looking at all of the admissions, your admission rate, operational capacity, and your average length of stay kind of led us down the path of how we project. You'll see on that chart, it talks about classified, where we add 20%. Again, that goes to the ability to properly classify and separate offenders. And then the peaking ratio at 1.24. So it shows in 2025, should have an average daily population around 216 and a classified and peak need of 322. All the way to 2045, your classified and peak need about 337 beds. So after calculating all of your bed projections and your future needs, we then started looking at options. And I'm going to turn this over to Brian, let him walk you through how those are.
Please do.
Maybe your eyes better.
Well, I got my glasses. Thank y'all for having us. I'm Brian Payne with Moseley Architects. I'm going to walk you through a couple of options, three of them to be exact, of what we did as part of the study. The first option is basically a standalone facility offsite somewhere in the county. We actually worked with county staff, and there was a couple of parcels in the county that this project fit. And so that's what we studied here, was basically a brand new jail facility on a site not in downtown Rutherford. So this is designed for about 337 inmates, is what your bed calculations told us is what the need was by whatever year that was, 2040, 2045. And so that would be your total build out of this. This option is a brand new core, brand new bed count. It's pretty efficient design. We've used something similar in other counties in the state, and it's worked out well. I think the downside of anything that I share with you tonight is cost, because none of these options are cheap in today's dollars that we're dealing with in the world of construction. Things are not cheap. So this option, because I can't see either, I'll have to bring my cheat sheet with me. This was about a 95,000 brand new square feet, and it was roughly $73 million. And that is the total project cost, not just bricks and mortar. That was fees and any kind of inspections and anything like that, land acquisition, those types of things that would have been factored into that. So that would be a total project cost. Option number two was kind of a complex idea of, can we keep something on the current jail site? And as you can see there, it really created a phasing nightmare there, because there's so much going on that site with the existing courthouse, a lot of parking going on there, the existing sheriff's office and the existing detention center. We had to take the approach of looking at it from a phasing standpoint of what had to come first, what came next, those type things. So, and we had to look at making sure all those existing facilities remained operational during all these activities. This is kind of a problematic approach. The site is very small. It's very crowded with all these facilities there. So as you can imagine, it got complex and it got costly. The idea for this one, one thing I did want to point out too, is if you were to go this route, there really is no future expansion on this site. This really kind of maximizes the site. This would be involved with creating a new parking deck so you can get rid of some of the parking there adjacent to the courthouse and the detention center. This did try to manage to salvage the existing 164-bed tower that's on as part of the detention center. So that was kept as part of this and reused. But it did involve creating a brand new core and then some additional housing as an addition to that. As you can see, this roughly gave you 248 new beds, which coupled with that existing tower that we were trying to repurpose and reuse, brought you to a bed count of about 412. And this is about an $80 million project, about 70,000 new square feet for that
one. One thing, just like on options two, estimate, we had cost escalation of 12 months. We also had some contingency. But under contingency and design.
Thank you, Tom, for pointing that out. So we took a step back and we said, okay, well, what could we do with the existing building? And can we renovate the existing building to continue to utilize it moving forward? So this option number three that we've titled number three here basically creates 156 new beds. We were also trying to keep that existing 164-bed tower that you currently have. So this option brings you to a total of 320 beds. And then we went into kind of a complex renovation process of that existing portion of the building there, that one-story building. Now, this did need, for this to work, really the sheriff's office needs to be relocated to a different facility. That way we get enough square footage available in the building for the other needs associated with this size facility once you get up to about this 320 beds, if that makes sense. And then this option here, cost-wise, this created about 36,000 new square footage, and that was roughly $45 million there on that option. So those were the three options. I know I went through those quickly, but, you know, we can talk about questions here in a moment, but I think we do have a kind of a wrap-up slide of what our recommendations were coming out of this study for you guys. One, like I said before, I think it was 336 beds are needed there by 2045. We wrote down that 90% of those need to be two-man occupied cells and 10 were a single restrictive housing type unit. We thought, like Todd had mentioned, it's good to continue to reduce and maintain that average length of stay. Any kind of option you can to reduce that is always good. Provide different types of cell housing there, improve sight lines, continue making necessary repairs, which we understand you guys have done a great job in continuing to make those repairs. And then implement an inmate classification plan. And then there's a couple of other points there. But I'll stop there and for sake of brevity and ask if there's any questions that we can help address.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
When I look at option three, when you look at the new structure attached to the current tower, and you look at the control room, why wouldn't you rotate that to where the tower could still be utilized for the new section two?
We studied that, and that was our first approach with that. The problem is the length of that building. You start getting into the third street there, the roadway. Now, I guess if you work with the town and close that street, yes, that may be an option. We could study that a little bit more to see if that would work. But without knowing that, we didn't go that direction.
That's a great question. That is the first route that we looked at trying to do that.
Well, I mean, that's the purpose of the tower and having the control rooms there. And to be able to be in the center, it's like, you know, just like option one, when you look at that, the new design is the design nationwide. When you do a nursing home type spoke wheel where you have the control tower in the center, and you literally can look down every hall to see what you need. If you have somebody that needs assistance, you instantly know it. There's no blind spots, basically.
And it helps you with staffing efficiency, which right now trying to hire law enforcement public safety staff is very difficult. Right.
And a comment as well, too. I do like the idea of having the tower aligned, or the building aligned with the tower. It makes a lot of sense. There's a lot of traffic that goes down that street there. And it doesn't necessarily have to travel down the street. By aligning that building to the tower so that it can be utilized as a tower, not have to shift the shift some of your guards there and put them in the arm. By shutting that street down, you can additionally make sure that we have a pathway between the detention center and the courthouse secure, thereby, if not eliminating, almost eliminating any chance of having a runner from time to time. And that does happen. You see that in the paper several times a year. So in terms of that, I think it would be the best utilization of our money at that. This is merely discussion.
I think you raised a great point, Commissioner Hunt, that we did observe that that's a pitching curve. And I do think that's something that the county should.
So during your discussions with everyone, you hadn't at one point talked to the town to see about closing the street, or is this the first time?
The city did not get into that portion. We did not charge
them. I think the
charge was to give us options. I just wonder where that option was.
Yeah, I think the conversation was that's a county commissioner's kind of decision if we try to close that street. Mm-hmm. Closing the street sometimes can be difficult. To do that, have great benefits.
Yeah, we could optimize parking and
the staff inmate control. Safety, moving inmates across the court.
Yeah.
Amen to that.
But that wasn't considered then.
That was the first thing we looked at.
I mean, we just stopped there at that point. On the ALOS, I would like to publicly state that our detectives, law enforcement, our public defenders, judicial systems, our DA, they've been doing a terrific job in prosecuting the cases and moving cases forward. It's truly a team effort, making sure that when your officers are there on their day to be in court, the reports are completed, the public defenders are there, the DA, the judge. That is why the ALOS is so low and saving the taxpayers money by getting those folks through the system as quickly as possible instead of us paying the daily rate of holding those prisoners in the local detention center. But we do have a new courtroom coming, which should help alleviate any help by ALS as well, which we're investing in. But if I do my math right, at your first bid, if it's 8 cents, that would add 8 cents to the tax rate. We'd have to pay, what, $8 million a year to service that debt? So we would have to raise taxes then to cover $8 million worth of debt at that first option for a brand new. I don't know if you were sitting here an hour ago, but okay, all right. All right. And then the other ones, if you do the lower, it'd be $4 million and 4 cents. Okay. Yes, sir.
But then we're dealing with either a new facility or eventually, if you got enough land on option one, if you did it, make the commitment, then you can eventually have a new courthouse. Our courthouse is going to be 100 years old in, what, 2 more years? It's got the same square footage it had 100 years ago. There's so much growth you can do. We're landlocked where we are sitting there, and I'm not advocating new, but I'm just saying I have worked in a facility or been tied to it that when the courthouse joins with it and they build a whole new complex, it adds on if you got the room for it, and yes, it's money, and that's what we don't have. But I'm just saying it makes sense to grow new than to keep repairing and patching old stuff, in my opinion, because your numbers aren't that far apart when you look at them, and you've still got the same stuff, same problems. How old is this jail now? 40 years old? I mean, there's
parts of it 71.
Right.
71's the oldest.
I was there when we had the old Sally Port. And I mean, it was different. 38 years ago.
You know, when I was in there, it was just, it's gotten better, but it's time to maybe change, in my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Are there any questions regarding the presentation? No. All right. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Commissioners, next item is 3765. Yes, sir.
There you have it, word for word with no edits. Feel free to share this. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.